Drink in Me, the story of Timothy D. Lytton. Written by Timothy Daniel Lytton. Smell and taste. Three things that can never be hidden: the sun, the moon, and the truth, Buddha. Somehow, this book ended up in your hands. I am sure you either stumbled upon it by accident, heard about it, and felt a bit of morbid curiosity, or you are in prison, and the only two options on the book cart were either this or free on the inside. Whatever the case may be, you're in luck because I have quite an unbelievable story to tell you, one I'm confident will capture your intrigue, and at the very least, you will find it entertaining. It is an intimate narrative about my life story and how I've become the person I am today. Who am I, you ask? No one special, no one famous. I haven't invented a billion-dollar company, gone from rags to riches, broken any world records, or have an earth-shattering secret that can change your life. I am just one of over 8 billion people in the world who each have their own stories to pour out and let everyone else drink in, and this is just one of them. We all have a unique life and an interesting story to share, and we all carry our own cross to drag and bear. Everyone's process is the same. You're born, you live some years, and then you die. While the born and die parts of life are universal for every human, there is only one birth and one death, but it is the living of life that separates each person and creates a snowflake life that is unique to no one else. Like every snowflake that falls from the sky, our lives and experiences are all very different, and our snowflakes are shaped by a combination of what we actively choose to do for ourselves and reacting to what other people do to us. However, as you will soon discover, my snowflake has been strewn and shaped by some harsh, extraordinary, and incredible things along the way. My story is a unique one. It's a heartbreaking and messed up one that may, at times, seem too far-fetched and unbelievable to be real. It has a little bit of everything that makes a train wreck hard to turn away from, and you might think it's a Hollywood script or some B-rated movie. Occasionally, I find myself wishing it were merely a made-up movie. But sadly, sometimes life can be more intense and depressing than any fictional story or lousy movie. Just as the adage goes, truth can indeed be stranger than fiction. For this reason, do not worry about offending me by questioning what I am writing, because if I had not lived it, I would find it dubious at best. It is all true, though, and one of the best things about the truth is it never changes. We all know that there are always two sides to every story, and unfortunately, people only know the wrong side of mine. And that's not right or fair. So this book is my attempt to set the record straight and offer my side of events and let the reader decide. But before we take this little stroll down my memory lane, and before I get intimate and share my very personal thoughts, feelings, and secrets with you, we need to set the foundation and expectations for our new relationship as a writer and reader. Do you see how I carefully said writer and reader instead of author and reader? Let us be upfront and clear with each other from the start. I am no author. I am not even a writer, but I must define this book in some way. I did not graduate from college with a degree in literature or writing, and I have never written anything more than high school essays and letters to friends and family. Therefore, if you are hoping for a sophisticated book and a masterpiece of fine literature, I am very sorry to disappoint you. So instead of expecting to read your typical book, imagine us kicking back and having a casual chat and a friendly conversation and drinks over a few glasses of beer, tea, wine, coffee, weed, or whatever is your thing. If you can read my story in this way, we'll get through this as smoothly as possible. Here soon, you will understand why I did not get the opportunity to go to college, and who knows, I may have missed out on becoming a great author. Basically, if you lower your expectations for me now, you might not be disappointed and possibly let down later. I apologize in advance. This is my flaw and what I lack to bring to our new relationship, along with money and good looks. But if my lack of writing skills and broke ass is not a deal breaker and you are still intrigued enough to continue for now, let me assure you I do have some positive attributes I can offer in our relationship. I have a job, my own car, and I'm loyal. Plus, I will be open and honest with you. This part of my life will be like a literal open book to you. I kind of have no choice. No matter how embarrassing, shameful, or crazy parts there are to this story, I will be honest. I have nothing to hide, so let's go ahead and rip this band-aid off now. For the last 25 years, I've had to live my life marked as a sex offender and have been unfairly judged as one of the worst kinds of human beings. The truth has not been known, and I have had to bear the consequences of my silence. Not because of shame or guilt, but silence due to fear. I have personally experienced the destructive impact people in positions of power and authority can have, and if you have ever been abused or violated by authorities, you know how paralyzing and helpless it is. However, I know who I am and what I am not. I will be the first to admit I am only human and have made mistakes, and I am not even close to being perfect. And I can own up to and take responsibility for the actual and real mistakes I have made in my life. Likewise, I will not hold back the responsibility for those who have committed criminal acts and misdeeds against me. It is one thing when a regular person commits a crime, but when someone in a trusted authority does it, it magnifies it exponentially. The people whom this book is about had incomprehensibly wrecked my life, damaging my reputation by unjustly labeling me as a sex offender since I was 18 years old. At that age, I was seriously outmatched, like stepping into the boxing ring with a 20-year-old Mike Tyson. My life got messed up as badly as my face would get messed up by Tyson. But if I had to box Mike, I would at least try and throw a punch or two before he knocked me out. This book is my attempt to throw a punch back. I want to fight as best as I can with everything I've got. So why now, you might ask? The answer is that I have reached a point in my life where I do not have much left to lose. Nearly everything worth living for has been taken away, and I am left with one option or choice. To write this book, clear my name, and tell my side of this tragedy. If I don't, everyone will only know the lies and believe I'm some sex offender and villain. The reality is I am just an ordinary guy, no different from any other respectable and decent man. And the best way I can show the world the truth is to expose myself in the right way, share some of my most personal, intimate memories, and let everyone drink in a few glasses full of Timmy life and hope they can stomach it. So here's to revealing the truth, and to my brother Ricky, cheers. Glass number one, family is not an important thing, it's everything. MJ Fox. On Sunday, the 16th of March 1980, in the small town of Statesville, North Carolina, I, Timothy Daniel Lytton, was born, weighing 12 pounds. This caused me to get stuck coming out of my mother's vagina, which, after having 5 kids already, should have been well attuned to handling my big ass. She said the doctor had to cut her from pink to stink to get my broad shoulders out. This in turn made my mother bleed so much that she said she almost bled to death and I nearly drowned in her blood. I guess you can say from literally my first moments in life that I've had to rock it out and struggle to do things the hard way. I was the 6th of 7 kids to pop out of my mother, Diane. She was not your typical Pisces, speaking without a filter or shame, and she seemed to enjoy being the center of attention. She took pleasure in trying to shock people with her words and observing their reactions to her peculiar behavior. I believe she derived a different kind of satisfaction from intentionally embarrassing others. In total, she had 5 daughters and 2 sons. Growing up, I was surrounded by women, including my 2 grandmothers, 1 aunt, and 2 nieces. All my sisters had different personalities, and they were all beautiful women. My oldest sister, Wendy, was 13 years older than me and was a Scorpio with dark hair. When I was 6 years old, I was the ring bearer at her wedding. She married a guy named Bobby, and soon after, they had 2 girls, Kim and Tiff, making me an uncle before I turned 10. Wendy had a bold character and was not afraid to speak her mind. She loved the attention and was the type of person who would openly point out a giant pimple on someone's forehead for everyone to hear as if they were unaware of it. After Wendy was born, Diane met Wayne Lytton, a Scorpio and the man of her dreams. They quickly became pregnant. It's clear they both liked to bump the dumplings, judging by the number of children they had. The story goes when Diane discovered she was pregnant for the first time with Wayne's child, she went to him and said, "I'm pregnant and you're the father, so now you have to marry me." It was an unconventional way to get engaged, but it suited them well. Following that, Diane and Wayne hurriedly arranged their wedding before anyone noticed Diane's pregnancy. They managed to get married just in time, and shortly after the wedding, Christy, the first member of Wayne and Diane's team, was born. Christy was 9 years older than me and had always been a wonderful older sister. She was a Sagittarius with a quiet yet sweet and timid nature. Christy was incredibly generous and had a caring and gentle attitude, particularly toward animals. However, she could also be quite emotional and sensitive. A little over a year later, my sister Mary Jane, with her tan skin, black hair, and the gift of gab, was born. Whenever anyone wanted to know the truth, they could always turn to Mary. She was a Cancer sign, and her roller coaster of emotions could make her shift from calm to storm in the blink of an eye. Mary Jane loved to talk and flirt with her charm. She also had a compassionate nature and a big heart, and she was always protective of her family. About another year and a half later, Joanne, our other sister, followed. Jo, as we all called her, was a Leo sign, and like a lion, her loyalty was fierce. She was born with a severe case of cerebral palsy and had to undergo 6 major back surgeries by the age of 18. She was one of the strongest people I knew. She was there to help me whenever I needed it. Like all the other girls, Jo was blessed with beauty. She had dark hair and a soft, smooth complexion. It seemed like every guy who met her would fall in love and try to date her. 3 years later came my brother Ricky, who was a cancer like Mary Jane, and like most cancers, he had quick mood swings. Being only 3 years older than me, he was the primary male figure in my life, filling the role a father was supposed to. Rick was very intelligent, and growing up he was athletically gifted. He often teased me, but also had a great sense of humor. Instigating drama and stirring things up out of boredom were some of his character traits. 3 years after Rick was born, I was born. I was the only kid Wayne wasn't there for during the birth, and I guess this might be why he couldn't stand me. At the age of one, he gave me the only broken bone in my life. He threw me against the wall and broke my nose. Of course, I don't remember it, but Diane and Mary told me I wouldn't stop crying, and as everyone knows, the best way to get a baby to stop crying is to knock them out. Right? Sounds logical. I am a full Pisces, Sun, and Moon, with Taurus rising. Whether you believe in astrology or not, you cannot help but see the uncanny accuracy in how it describes someone's personality traits. I am, in fact, a logical and practical person and would be the first to question the veracity of Sunday's paper horoscope. But I have also wondered why so many different people share the same personality traits and how they seem to fit perfectly with their astrological signs. I figure there must be some truth or something that has allowed humans to keep using and studying it for thousands of years. Nikola Tesla and Manly P. Hall, two of history's intellectual giants, both had a connection to astrology. Tesla used astrology as inspiration and guidance in his innovative work, while Manly P. Hall, an esoteric scholar, was a staunch believer in astrology, seeing it as a tool for understanding the human psyche. It wasn't until I came across a lady named Meredith and her soul navigation videos that explained everything in a way that made sense to me. Her explanation of my birth chart finally explained why I am the way I am. I cannot deny the accuracy with which they describe a Pisces personality, and it is precisely how I am as a person. I'm a calm, laid-back, easygoing guy, and I have so much empathy and compassion for human beings and animals. I treat everyone the way I want to be treated. The golden rule should be the easiest to follow. I do not bother anyone, and I keep to my own business. I value my privacy like a fish values water. I believe in fairness, equality, and the precept of live and let live. I got to be the baby for a while because Jennifer, my youngest sister, came when I was 3. She was also a Pisces, and as we grew up together, I spent a lot of time with her. Her nickname was Bull, and she used to play football with me and my male friends in the yard until she hit puberty. Like all my sisters, Jennifer was sweet, kind, and beautiful, always there for me whenever I needed them. Jennifer also had a no-nonsense attitude and wasn't afraid to speak her mind. After my sister Jennifer was born, I fell into this no-man's land. I wasn't the oldest, I wasn't the firstborn son, and I was no longer the baby. I was just number 6. Navigating family dynamics and growing up in a less-than-ideal environment set the stage for some of the more complex and challenging experiences of my childhood. Like when I was 4 years old, we lived in a small apartment that had been divided from a large house into 2 separate units. Next to our apartment was another one where an elderly lady named Kitty lived with her 2 adult delinquent sons and a daughter. Tommy, Kitty's son, was an overweight and drunken bully. He was as unintelligent as he was mean-spirited. Diane, being the ever-so-caring mother, not only let Tommy bully and physically push us around, but also allowed us to wander around the apartments frequently without any supervision of any kind. Kitty was a dumbass. She used to keep a little .38 revolver handgun lying on the back of her couch headrest. One day, tired of being picked on by Ricky, I walked next door and sat on the couch. Kitty was in another room and no one else was around, so I reached my arm up, feeling with my hand, until I found the gun. I hopped off the couch, gun in hand, and headed straight for Ricky. When I saw him, I pointed the gun at him and said, "Bang, bang." I can't remember if I pulled the trigger or not, but the gun was loaded, so luckily I didn't shoot my brother. Of course, I was only 4 years old, and I was only hoping to finally have Ricky scared to pick on me. I mean, who the hell leaves a loaded handgun on the back headrest of their couch, knowing young kids are running around? I could not imagine living that down if something terrible happened. This harrowing experience mirrored the reckless abandon often seen in my early life and leads us to another peculiar yet significant moment from my childhood. You see, as a kid, I was unconventional. I used to run around outside naked in the winter and wear thick coats in the summer. I don't know why, but it helped to protect me from serious injuries. When I was 5 years old, my brother and I were playing outside on a summer day. I had my head down, busy moving rocks with a toy dump truck, when a car backed out of our driveway and ran over me, trapping my foot underneath. My foot became stuck or wedged somehow, and it seemed like the lady driving the car wasn't paying much attention and continued to back up without realizing she had run over a little kid. I can't recall if I screamed, because even if I did, the lady didn't hear me. Luckily, my brother saw the incident and rushed towards her car, leaping onto the hood and shouting, "You ran over my brother!" Finally, after dragging me underneath for a considerable distance of about 20 or 30 feet, the lady stopped. Following that, they lifted the car and freed me. However, the lady drove away before the ambulance arrived. Thankfully, despite having scratches on my face and suffering from a significant road rash on my hands, the injuries were not severe because I was wearing a thick winter jacket. If my brother had not noticed what the woman was doing, I'm uncertain if I would even be alive right now. Glass number 2. The beautiful thing about learning is that no one can take it away from you. B.B. King. My mother had to almost drag me into school on my first day of kindergarten because I was so bashful and nervous. Even at the early age of 5, I had anxiety and felt physically awkward. I told her I did not want to go because I was extremely shy and would hide behind her whenever I met someone for the first time. My mother tried to reassure me by telling me there would be a bunch of toys and other kids to play with, and I would have fun and make lots of friends. But the thought of all those strangers in an unfamiliar place terrified me even more. The one good thing my mom was halfway right about was I met my best friend, Mikey, who is still my best friend to this very day. My mom and I walked into Mulberry Street Elementary School in Ms. Chambers' kindergarten classroom. With wide eyes, I clung onto my mom's shirt, looking around all the children, laughing, playing, yelling, running, and hearing how loud it was. Taking in the chaos, I turned to my mother and said, "Nope," and I told her I was ready to go back home. She sat at one of the small round tables and said, "Let's just give it a minute." She pointed to the toy section of the classroom and said, "Oh, look at all the toys." As we were poor, I didn't have a lot of toys at home, so even though I tried my best, I couldn't resist. She told me to find a toy to play with and assured me she would be right there the whole time. I slowly made my way to the toys but kept looking back to ensure my mom was still there. I somehow got lost intensely examining the toys until the teacher instructed all the kids to sit on the floor in front of her chair. I thought to myself, "Not today," so I turned to the table my mother was sitting at, only to find she was gone. It took me a few more seconds to comprehend the situation, and I realized I had been tricked and was now alone in a room full of strangers. I began to have a full-blown panic attack and ran for the door. I stopped in the middle of the huge four-way hall and started crying, looking around for my mom. I wanted to run but didn't know how to go, so I stood in the middle of the hall, crying and lost. The teacher came behind me to try and soothe me, but when she put her hands on my shoulders, it only made me scream and kind of freak out a little. I do not like people I don't know touching me, and I especially hate it when anyone touches me when I'm upset. I know my head is not normal, but I am not a toucher, and when I am upset, I don't want anyone to touch me. Anyways, I started freaking out so badly the teacher had to get my sister, Joanne, from the other classroom. She was in one of the higher grades and came to calm me down. When I went back to the classroom, I still refused to sit with the other kids, and I sat on the floor in the back corner by myself. It had nothing to do with the other kids, I just felt so betrayed. I remember sitting in the corner feeling better with my back against the wall, and my arms crossed almost all day. It was not until later that afternoon I finally emerged from the corner and began playing with the toys. Mikey and I started playing with the little Hot Wheels cars, and we decided to build a ramp for the cars to jump and collide in the air together. Our plan worked a little too well, and one of the cars went flying and crashed into the teacher's leg. When she asked who had hit her, neither me nor Mikey said anything, so we both got punished and put in the corner. I returned to the corner I had been in all day. Since then, Mikey has been the best friend a guy could ask for. He is always loyal and there for me when I need him. Mikey is a Scorpio, and it turned out we had a lot in common, as Mikey also had a big dysfunctional family, with his mom and dad having 9 kids, 7 boys and 2 girls, and his dad was an alcoholic abuser like mine, though a lot smaller. We were always there for each other when one of us was mistreated, forming a strong friendship based on support and understanding. Growing up, everyone at school would call us brothers. Mikey and I grew so weary of explaining that we were just friends, we began to tell everyone we were cousins instead. This worked far better than having to explain who we were to one another each time. In the following years, we became inseparable. We did everything together, from riding bikes to roaming the neighborhood and causing trouble, mostly harmless but sometimes not. When we couldn't find something to do, we would create our own games like roof ball or build clubhouses in the woods, filling our imaginations with excitement. Throughout our childhood, Mikey was the one person who truly understood me, and I knew he would always be by my side. However, behind the facade of this close friendship was the harsh reality of my family life. My family was poor and were welfare recipients all my life. Sometimes Joe and I would sit on the porch and wait for the mailman on the first of the month to deliver the packet of food stamps. Food stamps used to come in an envelope and look like Monopoly money. I hated using paper food stamps in stores, as it would make me stand out and embarrass me. It was rough growing up poor as shit, having to wear baggy hand-me-downs that were already used before Ricky got them, which meant it was more like hand-me-down downs. On top of Wayne's abuse and the lack of encouragement and motivation at home, compounded with being the poor kid at school, it seemed like there was no hope. Overall, we had a dysfunctional family, and I could tell you so many disturbing stories about my childhood it would make you cringe and want to cry. I don't think my parents, Diane and Wayne, really wanted kids, let alone to have all the responsibilities that came with raising this many. Neither parent wanted to work good jobs. Diane was too lazy to work and instead liked to use a woman's unique power to hustle men for their money. Wayne would work off and on at different wood mills and lumber yards, but he wanted to keep the money for himself or spend it all on alcohol, drugs, and hookers. He got all his strength and muscles working those hard labor jobs. Ricky used to say a good bit of Wayne's strength came from what is called dum-dum strength. Wayne was 6'3 and 345 pounds of pure dum-dum strength. He had a deep, growling voice that was loud and extremely intimidating. Wayne's abusive, alcoholic, control freak behavior caused me and my siblings to suffer a lot of abuse. It did not help Diane couldn't keep from running around with any and every man. Wayne would catch Diane being unfaithful and use it as an excuse to get drunk and beat the shit out of me and my brother. He was always quick to anger and would dictate everything we did, including what games we could play and who we could play with. He even gave us nicknames and refused to call us by our real names. He seemed to enjoy beating me and my brother. Whenever he beat Ricky, he could not make him cry, which would make him angrier, and he would beat him even more. When he beat me, I would cry, and he would beat me more for crying, so it was a no-win situation with him. He has hit all of his kids except for Jennifer. Me and Ricky would sit up at night and talk about how, when we got bigger, we would beat his ass. Wayne would love to get drunk and give everyone a hard time. His idea of a Friday night movie snack was raw cabbage, sardines, and buttermilk that would make you gag. Whenever he pretended to be a parent, it was just to control or harass us, and it seemed more like entertainment for him. I recall one day when Ricky and I were outside, and Ricky was trying to teach me how to ride a bike. Wayne was, as usual, drinking and decided to teach me how to ride by pushing me towards some metal trash cans down a hill. Of course, he would get angry if you didn't figure it out on the third try, and would slap you across the head or push you even harder and faster the next time. Wayne would get angry if you could not learn anything within a short amount of time. He would live with us from time to time, constantly popping in and out of our lives, and when he was in, he would do more abuse and control than parenting. Diane was around and would sometimes get beaten too, but a lot of the time, she wanted us to stay out of her way and leave her alone. Here is a glimpse into what Wayne thought was parenting. Sometimes, when Wayne was drunk and wanted to terrorize someone, he would make me get a book and read it to him. I was only 7 or 8 years old and still learning to read. I hated reading to him because he was so intimidating and would already make me nervous. With Wayne, you could not stutter or stumble on your words, or it would piss him off, and he would smack the back of your head. Not lightly, either. I would always try to grab a book I already knew, or that was easy to read. This one day, though, I think Wayne had it in for me, or was extra drunk because he made me get a hard book from my grandmother's bookshelf. I started reading, and somewhere along the way, I started stuttering and stumbling at some of the big words. I came to a word I could not read and was stuck. Wayne got pissed and barked the word at me while he slapped the back of my head hard. I tried to keep reading as tears started to build up in my eyes, and it was hard to see the words. I was fighting back the tears, trying to keep reading, and Wayne was getting annoyed because, for whatever reason, I was not allowed to cry, ever. With my eyes full of tears and now my nose starting to run, when some tears or snot fell on the book, it sent Wayne over the edge. He snatched the book from my lap, held it in front of my face, and yelled, "Look at this nasty shit," and smashed the open book in my face with his other hand behind my head like you see when someone smashes a pie in someone else's face. He slung the book on the floor and slapped the back and side of my head again. This time, it was so hard that I flew forward and landed headfirst on the floor. Luckily, my forehead caught my fall. I do not know whether he knocked me out for a second or hitting the floor headfirst made me dizzy, but I was slow to sit up, and all I could see were black and white dots. Wayne was yelling at me to grab the goddamn book and get up. I could barely see because of the tears and black dots, so I just started feeling around on the floor for the book. I am reaching around, trying to hurry and find that Dan book, because when Wayne tells you to do something, you have to jump to it right then. Wayne gets up and slaps the back of my head again, hard enough to see even more dots, and grabs my shirt at the collar. He slides me like a fucking bowling ball across the floor and right into the wall. My back hit the wall, and I was still dazed, and my vision was still a little blurry, but I saw the book right beside me. He told me to get up and take the goddamn book to my room. I guess I wasn't getting up fast enough because he came over to me, grabbed my shirt again at the collar, jerked me up, walked me to the living room door, and shoved me hard out into the hallway right into the hallway wall, causing me to fall back down on my ass. I think my falling aggravated him because he huffed, goddamn it, and came up to me and gave me one more extra hard slap to the side of the head and jerked me up with two hands by my shirt and pants and carried me over to the bedroom door, throwing me like a fucking bale of hay across the entire room and onto the bed while I'm still clutching the book in my arms. This is just one of many similar stories from my childhood. You can get an idea of what life was like for my siblings and me during those years. I remember the cops were never any help. They would come and make Wayne leave, that's it. He would leave for an hour or two, only to return and pick up where he left off. We stopped calling the law and started calling my Grandma Hedrick, Diane's mother. My Grandma Ethel Hedrick was an Aries and was 4'10" and maybe 100 pounds soaking wet. She may have been a small package, but so is TNT and she was every bit as explosive. True to her zodiac sign, she was a little firecracker and the only one who put real fear into Wayne, and she always scared Wayne off. How might a small older lady like Ethel run off a 6'3", 345 pounds man? She always brought with her two small 22 caliber revolvers. Wayne knew Ethel would shoot him, either on purpose or accidentally. You see, Grandma's hands would shake when she pointed the guns, so it would not take much for her to pull the trigger accidentally. Whenever Wayne started one of his drunken rampages, we would lock him outside and call Grandma, and she would come over, get out of the car with her pants pulled up to her bosom and the two revolvers stuffed in her pants right in front. Wayne would try to run his mouth but would always go to his car and leave. I would stare out the window because I love to see someone put fear into Wayne for a change. Grandma would stand there with both hands on her guns as if daring Wayne to give her a reason to shoot him finally. I heard her tell him one time no jury would find her guilty of putting a bullet in his head. Because of the abuse, CPS was called a few times, but nothing was ever done. Diane cussed one of the CPS workers out, pushed him down the porch steps, and yelled at him until he got in his car and left, never to return. It was like the CPS workers did not want to do anything because they would always make sure to point out that if they took us away, my brother and sisters would all be separated and go to different homes. My brother and sisters were my life's only good and positive parts. I sometimes daydreamed that a rich family would come and take me and all my siblings to a nice, loving home so we could be safe and happy. Yet, even in the midst of such wishful fantasies, one particular real day stands out, bringing me back to the harshness of my life. When I was about 10 years old, I played outside with Ricky and Mary Jane. We wanted to build something for our Grandma Lytton in the yard, and we found a pile of what we thought was scrap wood, bricks, and wire next to an old wooden shed behind our house on Hill Street. Mary had a bunch of plastic flowers and suggested we build a cross.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.